Welcome to worship on this Sunday, the 31st of October. Happy Halloween, or All Hallows Eve, which leads into All Saints Day and then into All Souls Day. It's kind of like Christmas Eve in the sense that it's All Hallows Eve, which kind of over time became Halloween. November 1st is All Saints Day, when we remember our saints, and the 2nd is All Souls Day, when we remember our dead. And remember, in the Protestant faith, we see all as saints, even if we feel like sinners. Dressing up became part of the festivities, and it was a desire to scare away ghosts, and bonfires were used to celebrate the switch from summer into winter as the long, dark nights approach. Over time, we had more fun dressing up as zombies and witches, and of course, a way was found to profit from it. There is much blending of festivals from over the generations, including the Celts, the Roman Catholics, and others. Marking Halloween is a personal choice for Christians. Personally, Halloween's always been a part of my calendar growing up. We always had positively themed costumes, and my mum had an open kitchen where we all gathered to dunk for apples or eat donuts or treacle scones off a string. We went guising after the party in the village hall, and that was rural Scotland in the 1980s. And so it's something that has grown again, especially as we've taken on a lot of American culture and gone from guising, where you had to earn your treats, to trick or treat, where you either give a treat or you get tricked, and sometimes not in very pleasant ways. So we had to tell jokes like, why didn't the skeleton go to this scary movie? Because he didn't have the guts. Or, why was Cinderella bad at football? Because her coach was a pumpkin. I know. Both worthy of a good groan. I'm hoping that the young folks in church might have some better ones for us. Along with trick or treat, we have embraced pumpkins. In Scotland, that was turnips. And I don't know if you remember trying to carve out a turnip, but trust me, it's hard enough work on a pumpkin, never mind trying to do it on a turnip. But the desire then again was for light, to let light shine in the darkness. And as we have recognised over recent times, light shines very far in the dark. Paul reminds us that there are spiritual forces around us that we cannot hope to comprehend, but we are encouraged to walk in the light of Christ. Within the book of Daniel or Revelation, we are given glimpses of worlds that even our filmmakers can't design. And these 3 days remind us that the line between life on earth and life beyond death, as we know it, is blurred. We can't see it, but we trust in God who holds it all in place, and it's him that we worship. So I want to share a heavenly vision recorded in the book of Daniel, and it comes from Daniel chapter 7, just a few verses from Daniel 7. In the first year that Belshazzar was king of Babylonia, I had a dream and saw a vision in the night. I wrote the dream down, and this is the record. While I was looking, thrones were put in place. One who had been living forever sat down on one of the thrones. His clothes were white as snow, and his hair was like pure wool. His throne, mounted on fiery wheels, was blazing with fire, and a stream of fire was pouring out from it. There were many thousands of people there to serve him, and millions of people stood before him. The court began its session, and the books were opened. During this vision in the night, I saw what looked like a human being. He was approaching me, surrounded by clouds, and he went to the one who had been living forever and was presented to him. He was given authority, honor, and royal power, so that the people of all the nations, races, and languages would serve him. His authority would last forever, and his kingdom would never end. Amen. Let us pray. Holy and heavenly one, We have no right to call your name, yet through Christ you welcome us and in the Spirit you enable us. Therefore we pray, Holy God, that though you rule over all, and your enemies are but a footstool below your feet, that you would be pleased to be amongst us, that we might truly worship you and rejoice in all your splendour. May our faith catch sight of your holiness, that we might gasp in awe. May your Spirit be at one with our being, that we would experience your greatness. May our love blossom, our hearts swell, our eyes open and our minds relax, that we might truly know, if only for a moment, the magnitude, the sheer wonder, the unimaginable beauty of your presence. As Moses burned bright with your glory, may we burn bright with the light of Christ and chase the darkness from our hurting communities and broken hearts. Join with us in the here and now, that we might glimpse the now and the not yet. In your name we pray. Amen. We're going to sing together the song, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder. Because with the young folk today in church, we're considering what heaven is. And we're looking at that whole idea of what we imagine heaven to be. You know, whether heaven is a place that we get to, that we could program into our GPS. And I did do that. I put heaven into my sat-nav to see what would come up. And believe it or not, a hairdresser's in Cathcart. But something tells me that's not heaven either. But just encouraging us to think a little bit about what it means to be part of heaven. And with the young folk, we're saying to them, it's not a place that we can get to or buy a ticket for, but it's a place where we go because we have embraced Jesus as the way, the truth, and the light. So sing together, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder, I'll Be There.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder.
We come together in a time of prayer and we close this with the Lord's Prayer. Join with me as we pray together. Let us pray. Loving God, we gather together to praise your name and worship. We are so thankful that no matter where we go or what we do, you are with us. Whether we are up to our neck in work or running round the playground, whether we are walking the dog in the pouring rain or enjoying a coffee in the shops, whether we are in church or cleaning the house, housebound or in hospital, we can still sing your praise. We thank you for the gift of Jesus who shows us the way to heaven. And we know that it doesn't include us earning personal points or gold stars. We don't pay for it with money or good deeds. We are all welcome. And when we look to Jesus, we see how to live our lives in the here and now. We trust that through his death on the cross, through his resurrection, alive once again, that all are welcome because you so loved the world. We know that we don't live the way we should. We are bad-tempered, grumpy, selfish, and look to self before others. We curse others rather than bless them, and we abuse the world around us in the name of convenience and greed. Forgive us, Lord, that we value things over people and let fear trump love. Restore our sense of pride in our faith, our God, our world, that we might work together for you, for each other, for ourselves, and yes, even for those we think who don't deserve it. Today, as we consider heaven and saints and more, Lord, may we be reassured that our future is assured in you, in this world and the next. In your name we pray, and together we share in the family prayer of your children. We pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Today's reading comes from Revelation chapter 7, verse 9 to 17, the enormous crowd. After this, I looked, and there was an enormous crowd. No one could count all the people. They were from every race, tribe, nation, and language, and they stood in front of the throne and of the Lamb, dressed in white robes, and holding palm branches in their hands. They called out in a loud voice, "Salvation comes from our God, who sits on the throne, and from the Lamb." All the angels stood round the throne, the elders and the four living creatures. Then they threw themselves face downwards in front of the throne and worshipped God, saying, "Amen. Praise, glory, wisdom, thanksgiving, honour, power and might belong to our God for ever and ever. Amen." One of the elders asked me, "Who are these people dressed in white robes, and where do they come from?" "I don't know, sir. You do," I answered. He said to me, "These are the people who have come safely through the terrible persecution. They have washed their robes and made them white with the blood of the Lamb. That is why they stand before God's throne and serve him day and night in his temple. He who sits on the throne will protect them with his presence. Never again will they hunger or thirst. Neither sun nor any scorching heat will burn them, because the Lamb, who is in the centre of the throne, will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to the springs of life-giving water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you to Alison for bringing us that reading from Revelation, that last book in the Bible that is full of wonderful passages, but also quite a challenging read for us in this day and age. And we might struggle a little bit to comprehend it. And to be fair, today I'm not going into the text in great detail, but perhaps it's one of those books that we will tackle in 2022. But it's important for us to consider what life is about, but not just life, but death, because death is part of life. And in the church, we think about life after death. So I wanted to explore that a little bit today on this being Halloween and then All Saints and then All Souls. And of course, leading up even to Armistice Day and Remembrance Day as we head into November, really a season where we remember those who've gone home before us, some people like to say, who have gone to heaven. And we just want to remember their lives, their example, their legacy. Indeed, we have a memorial service coming up in November for those who lost loved ones during these past 18 months or so and had to grieve in ways that we just haven't had to do in the past. And so it's an opportunity to remember together loss, but also to be reassured, to be encouraged, to be inspired. So I hope that you'll join with me as I just think for a little bit about what it might mean to see beyond the third horizon. The idea being that we look into a future that's unwritten, that's unknown, but somehow there are elements of what we know even there. It's said that faith is just a crutch to get us through the horribleness of life. Somehow our beliefs help us to live like some kind of fairy tale magic or potion. At best, we're moralistic, and at worst, we are insane. Indeed, others pity us like we're somehow weird or wired wrong. And just a few others wish that they could believe what we believe because of the hope, the patience, the grace, the courage that we find, something different about us. I grew up with faith all around me, right through my primary school. It was very evident there. The school I went to, we prayed the Lord's Prayer every day. We said grace. We did Bible stories. We talked about missionaries. And it was all part of my education. But it was also in the family home, so to speak. My father came to faith when I was about 12, despite having also grown up surrounded by faith and spending much time in the military. But Jesus was to him perhaps like a figurehead, perhaps like the Queen, respected but not for sitting down with to shoot the breeze. My mum came to faith, I believe, when she was about 26, and she took a leaf out of Mrs. Wesley's book. John and Charles Wesley's mother used to put a blanket over her head to signify when she was in prayer with her God. My mum didn't use the blanket. Well, occasionally, actually, yes, she did. But mostly we just knew she was having what she called her QT or quiet time. My dad is a bit more like me and has a tendency just to kind of blurt out all the God stuff. And I remember him getting in trouble once in Oban for turning the speakers at an open air so they bounced off the valley walls. Everybody got to hear the message that day. So I have grown up in a kind of faith-filled environment, and I don't truly know what it is to live without faith. I know what it is to make a commitment to God, but I don't necessarily know what it is to live without faith. What I do know is I've told God on several occasions to get lost, particularly as a teenager and a young adult. I can't actually commit to that. I have tried, but I have found that to try and separate myself from God is, it just hurts too much. It's like trying to cut off a piece of my body without anaesthetic. When I've gone through the valley of the shadow of death, and I have been there, when a dear friend and colleague died in her early 40s, our boys the same age, or when the world collapsed around me in 2018, or believe it or not, I still remember when I couldn't answer that maths question in primary school and I prayed over it. And I got the answer right, but I got teased rotten because those around me realised what I had done. We sing songs like Jesus is the rock upon which we stand and all other ground is sinking sand. And for me, that probably is one of the kind of central ways of understanding my faith, because I do believe that Jesus is the rock upon which I stand and that there isn't any other way to be. And it's the truth by which I live and by which I die. And when it comes to death, we live with the hope and the assurance of life to come. We don't understand necessarily the life to come, but we believe that this isn't all there is, that God is so much more than what we see around us. The two passages we've had from Scripture today, from the Old Testament and the New Testament, speak of this third horizon, that which we know is out there, but we can't quite see it in similar terms. Of people and praise, of thrones and authority. And there's not a single mention of pearly gates and golden harps and even fluffy clouds. We believe that Jesus returned to his Father's side and that he intercedes for us. That one day we will walk with God and he will walk with us. The Garden of Eden story is reflected in the visions in the passages from Revelation. God walked with Adam and Eve in the cool of the day. In the new heaven and the new earth, we will walk with God in the streets. Of course, there's a certain arrogance that we have as human beings that somehow we are the pinnacle of creation. And yes, we're made in the image of God. And yes, there is something about us that is special. But we are sentient beings and we can use curiosity, science, knowledge, experience, and so much more to explore. But at the same time, we are our own worst enemy, because we also murder and destroy lives, creation, reputation, cultures, and so on. We reap what we sow. Animals look after their environment so much better than we do. Nature finds a way to thrive and adapt, even in the strangest of circumstances. It makes me smile when I see a freshly laid pavement or some such thing, and the weeds still find a weak spot and push their way up as if to say, "You'll never get rid of us." These few days of Halloween, All Saints, All Souls, challenge us to think about mortality. And it's not something that, you know, we naturally want to do. Yet as Christians, it shouldn't be something that we're afraid of. Perhaps it's no coincidence that COP26 starts with today, followed by these two other days. We do look forward to what will be, but that's not an excuse to blow up the planet in the process. This isn't about live a hedonistic life because we're going to go to heaven and all this is going to be scrapped anyway, so we might as well do what we please. That's not what we're about as Christians and followers of Jesus, and that is not what is expected of us. What is actually expected of us, and what is amazing, is that God has entrusted us with this gorgeous planet and with each other, this wonderful, diverse mix of human beings. And we're called by him to work with him and to live for him and for the benefit of one another and the world around us. We are supposed to live in harmony with one another. And we struggle to do that with our own kind. It is probably no wonder we can't live in our created world the way we should. He knows that this world is broken by sin, and that comes in all shapes and sizes. But we are also caught in the midst of a spiritual war that we can barely grasp and we very rarely reflect upon. But it's hinted at throughout our scriptures, right back in the story of the Garden of Eden, right through to Revelation. There is so much more going on than what you or I can or ever will see. What we do believe is that the war is won, but the battles and skirmishes continue. We are God's children in the name of Jesus Christ, his Son. And so, therefore, we can look beyond the here and now, the first horizon, what we can actually see and where we live and what we do, to the second horizon, to the third horizon, If the second horizon is heaven, then the third horizon, the new heaven and the new earth. We can't quite see it. We just know it's there. And we trust God to lift us to that place. We might not get swept up in a chariot of fire or disappear from view. More likely, we're going to slide in quietly, not entirely sure how we made it. But when we arrive, everything will fall into place. The struggles that shaped us, the suffering that molded our hearts to know compassion, the joy and love we knew that inspired and encouraged us, all comes together in that white robe and that deep peace that nothing will ever shatter once again. What we cannot even comprehend right now, no matter how hard we try, we will fully understand then. It will make perfect sense. What I know in part now, then I will fully know, even as I am already fully known. I don't believe that heaven is going to be harps and wings. I believe we will live and love as we were always supposed to do in this new heaven and this new earth. I do believe in relationships, in living together, possibly even in working, in being good stewards, in all the things that we're supposed to have got right the first time and didn't. Yet each day we glimpse just a little bit of what will be. In those perfect, if brief, moments of absolute love and contentedness, you know, the ones that you wish you could just bottle up and hold on to forever. In those moments when we capture nature in full praise and you're just wow, you're just wowed by it. Whether it's something as simple as a flower that opens or a beautiful rainbow that splits the sky or a landscape that's just droppingly beautiful. When our hearts burn with hope, even when the world around us is in complete chaos, or when we stand at the coffin and weep with loss, yet rejoice with faith. When we have that deep peace that nothing can shatter, even when everything lies broken around us. We are very aware of the loss of loved ones and members of the church and communities who are living with grief. Yet even though sorrow comes through the night, we believe that joy comes in the morning. For me, I couldn't live without faith in God's future. I genuinely don't believe I could live without having that faith, that hope, that trust that there is a third horizon with God. Don't get me wrong, faith frustrates me too, but that's part of growing and learning and maturing, and that I might trust him even more, that I might somehow connect even more with God, who is so much more than even the church has ever made him out to be. And I pray that when I die, I will go with good grace and folks will rejoice over me and for me. And I pray that you'll be partying when you do that, like I hope to be as well. And maybe I will get to play the harp. I kind of fancy giving that a go, to be honest. But as you remember our saints, your saints, loved ones who walk the streets with God, may you rejoice. Blessed are they who mourn, for they shall be comforted. It's absolutely fair enough to miss them, because we are human beings and Jesus himself wept too. But we worship Jesus, who is the resurrection and the life. And yes, that's just amazing and awe-inspiring and almost too big for us to comprehend. But we trust and believe in him who is the first and the last. Indeed, Jesus reminds us all when he says this: "Now, as for the dead rising to life, haven't you ever read what God has told you? He said, 'I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He is the God of the living, not the God of the dead.'" We live in him, through him, for him, with him. and because of him, we have eternal life. For God so loved the world. Lord, may we live with faith, hope, and love, that with you all will be well. To you be all praise and honour. Amen. Couple of quick wee notices, especially if you're local for us. Session and boards are meeting this week on Thursday at 7 o'clock here in the church sanctuary. On Saturday the 6th, we're joining the Global Action Day, and there'll be a vigil in the garden from 12 till 3. You're welcome to come along for some or all of it as we just make our own wee stand to support those who are marching in Glasgow and those who are marking this Action Day around the world. There'll be opportunities for prayer, music, and opportunities just to make placards and promises and just to reflect on how we might change the way that we live in order to support the world God gave us to look after. Pray for those who are in mourning, and we do have funerals of members this week, and I invite you to hold the families of Rachel Morrison, Jean Gordon, and Bob Patterson in your prayers. Let us come before God in prayer, and we've got our offering prayer followed by prayers for others. Loving God, we give thanks that because of Jesus' example, prejudice no longer binds us, fear has lost its power, and all that makes us weak has met its match in Christ. We bring our offerings to you, acknowledging that all your gifts are given for our own growth and for the service of humankind. Receive them and our worship. Accept us and show us the gifts we do not know we have to offer. In the strong name and by the wisdom of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We continue with prayers for others. Loving God, we come in prayer and acknowledge your eternalness. To be honest, God, with our finite minds, we do not understand, but we pray for the wisdom to know and the curiosity to explore faith and life in you. We measure time and in doing so give it control over us. We become slaves to its relentlessness, forgetting that in you we are eternal beings. We live broken and battered, distracted from the joy and beauty of life. Help us to appreciate the gift of temporary, to live gently and lightly, and to leave legacies worthy of you. We pray that our lives would bless one another and bless the generations that follow us. Help us to waste less, to live more generously, and to give away rather than hoard. We pray for the actual beginning of COP26. We pray for leaders who hold power and yet live in fear of those who hold the purse strings. We pray for protesters who beg, plead, and demand for creation and for humanity. We pray for those who bear the brunt of the inconvenience in these days and pray for patience and mercy. We pray that we would pull together, that all of your creation might be blessed. We think of those who now reside with you and thank you for their love, their example, their legacy, for the generations who have blessed your church, in whose footsteps we walk. We thank you. God of all people, not only the achievements of the great, but also the kindness of the humble, has touched and influenced our lives for good. For the ordinary saints who helped your kingdom take root and grow among us, we praise you. Mothers and grandmothers, fathers and grandfathers, common heroes and unsung servants of the kingdom who have let us see Jesus. We bless you for our fellowship with those whom you have called to greater life, and we prize the company of those who still live around us. Lord, find a place for all of them in paradise, and bring us with your saints to glory everlasting. In the name of God who was and is to come, we pray. Amen. Our next song, our closing song for our short service today is Through the Love of God, Our Saviour, All Will Be Well. Thank you. Thank you to the Clydebank Salvation Army for the music for that last hymn, and I hope that you found it encouraging and inspiring as you sang along with it. Thank you for joining with us today. I hope that the service has been a blessing to you, and I look forward to catching up with some of you in the course of the week ahead. I want to share with you our blessing. God loves you so very much. Bless our hearts, O God, with the love of Christ. Bless our minds, O God, with the wisdom of Christ. Bless our bodies, O God, with the power of the resurrection of Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you, now and forevermore. Amen.